I'm in the middle of my move, but I want to be here with you dissecting the crazy stuff that's going on in music today. No long intros. Let's get started. NDA with Billie Eilish. You're going to want headphones for this if you want to catch all the details and intricacies, because they are masters of tucking things in a really clever, awesome way. So let's take a listen. Did you think I'd show up in the limousine? Now, just commenting about that intro, I mean, that could almost be anything. If I had to make a guess, this is the kind of creative duo that could have easily homemade this, but if I had to guess how to achieve this easily on your own, it would probably be using something like an Ava Music Group pack, something from the cinematic trailer space that you can mangle the ADSR with and have it swell up into the beginning of your song. Did you think I'd show up in the limousine? No. Had to save my money for security. So many cool vocal things to talk about, but hold it. Says he's Satan and he'd like to meet. I bought a secret ass when I was 17. Okay, let's talk about these first four bars here. So there's some really cool, already starting off with cool production layering. I've definitely been really into the concept of not starting with a bare vocal and then layering it up, like starting big and dense and thick, and then playing with that aloneness as we develop the track. And they do a great job of that here. So up the middle, we have the main Billie doing the melody. Did you think it's open in the machine? Did you think, da, 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 da. We have that Billie up here in the front, in the middle, and then we have, it sounds like two doubles of the melody, but then we have, I believe, at least four other Billies doing this kind of descend bendy thing. And the most popular example of that is Shake It Off by Taylor Swift in the bridge. Oh, da, 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 da. It's this very kind of bratty tone, the way that she does it, where she's descending down and just bending it down like that. There's a really interesting bend going on top of those doubles. So check out the sides. Did you think it's open in the machine? Did you think I'd show up in the limousine? Did you think I'd show up in the limousine? No. Had to save my money for security. And then there's just the doubles. And then I think those bendy chromatic descent ones come back. Got a stalker walking up and down the street. Got a sucker walking up and down the street. And it's tucked in there, but what it does is it's not just a straight melody we're hearing. It's not as pure as just hearing the melodic content. We have some nice dissonance going on, which very much makes sense for the tone of this song. And it's leveled and mixed and performed in a way that's very tucked in the back. So you don't really necessarily hear it off the bat. Got a stalker walking up and down the street. Says he's Satan and he'd like to meet. I bought a secret ass when I was 17. Same thing there. Haven't had a party since I got the keys. I think there's one other. Haven't had a party since I got the keys. Had a pretty boy over, but he couldn't stay. On his way, I made him sign an NDA. So there's a couple of things going on. I haven't even talked about the beat yet. So we obviously have this four on the floor, laid back groove. Haven't had a party since I got the keys. Had a... But what's really interesting is there's a couple of percussive layers in there that I'm really, really excited about. So we have just the main kick, that snare, that main snare. They're very much setting up this snare to be really calm, really quiet, really contained. So that big smackaroony of a snare that comes in the big section feels huge. And I'm always yelling at people about this. And it's the use of contrast. We can't have every snare be huge. Otherwise, I mean, in pop music, right? Metalheads, Def Leppard is going to disagree with me on this. But in pop music, the intricacies of where a lot of pop is heading is we need to use contrast to really have something small that then makes the big part feel even bigger. So by the fact that they're using a really close in, saying like clink, clunk, clunk sound here, makes the huge snare feel enormous down the line instead of just reusing the same sound over and over for a genre like this. Haven't had a party since I got... It's more like a wood block, and then we have this very light shaker, very quiet. Haven't had a party since I got the keys. Had a pretty boy over. And then there's all these hits in between on the eighth notes. So the do, 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 do. There's all these little hits in between. Haven't had a party since I got the keys. Had a pretty boy over, but he couldn't stay on his. It sounds like it might even be a synth that is, they're just using the attack of the synth and no sustain. I can't quite tell, but one of those two, and it creates a great balance to the groove. And then after beat four, we have some very light woodblock-esque hits happening. So. Haven't had a party since I got the keys. Had a pretty boy over buddy. Really quiet, but one more time. Since I got the keys, had a pretty boy over buddy. That's nice. That's nice. That's nice. Also, my cat is going wild. Okay, well, see how this goes. And of course, we have the bass. It's pulsing. I didn't even comment about it, but I mean, it's just pulsing this one note. There's one other little hidden sound that's so tucked in, I can't even. It's about 30 degrees panned off to the right side. It's right before, right on the word keys. So invisible, but it is there and it is really cool. That is badass. You can actually hear it there. That thing is dope. Okay, so coming into this section, we have probably the most iconic, you know, I mean, this song is full of iconic sounds, so that's kind of diminishing, I think, what NDA brings to the table and its sonic creativity and vastness. But I know this is a sound we don't expect, or just something I've come to expect that I will not expect what I hear next the first time in a Billie Eilish song. Anything that her and her brother do together is just always exciting and compelling and unexpected. And so we have that main fake banjo. I can't even tell if it's a real or fake one because there's that bend that is clearly processed, but that could be them doing it in post. But they do some cool stuff. It's this very hidden layer of reverb pan going on with the tail of the sound. You're gonna need headphones for this, but check this out. The sound starts in the middle, and then when the decay, the reverb, is on its own without the melody, it goes doo doo doo. It goes a little to the left and then they throw it to the right. Really cool. And then there's this little percussive. You can make an argument that that sound may or may not have been a little changed. It's very hard to tell when it's under the vocal, if that low and high octave were there kind of panned out how they are now. But either way, you know, it's still great. Now, here in these vocals, what's really interesting is the fact that they got rid of the lead here. They got rid of the center lead. Right, so. And then she comes back there, which is really nice. It's a great way to have like a conversation with yourself, is to eliminate the lead vocal and to just have the doubles, and then you kind of respond to it with the center lead up the middle. Now, of course, we have the organ swelling up already here leading into the next bar, which I thought was really elegantly done. Really nice. And there's this little screech. That sounds like the same sound from our intro here. But like an octave lower, maybe EQ'd in a certain way, or an octave high. There's some wild filtering, but it's very similar tones. You couldn't save me, but you can't let me go. Oh, you know we have a lot to talk about right now. You know we do. So, yeah, here we are. The moment that I think a lot of people want to talk about. At least I do, as a songwriter, producer, fan of Billie Eilish. I am full stan at this point. But let's unpack this. First off, arrangement wise, there's some really interesting things that we've done up until this point. The entire song has sat on one minor chord. I don't have a keyboard in front of me, nor do I have Charlie Puth pitch, so. Whatever pitch that is, we sat on it for almost a full minute. One chord for a full minute. And so now, the fact that we are changing it up, we actually have harmonic movement. So it's a great tool. They intentionally are just sitting on one spot to keep this ominous. Interestingly, the fact that they sit on one chord for so long makes you feel like uncomfortable that there's so little movement happening. That's at least how I felt when I first heard this song. I was like, where is this going? It's going to go somewhere. It's driving me nuts. Let me get to this point here. So it's the first time that we're getting harmonic movement, which then, of course, opens up the song into this big next moment. It's also the first time we're getting legato. First time we're getting legato synth keyboard sounds instead of these little plickety-pluckety bits and the kind of staccato bass line of before. And then, of course, we have her voice adding distortion as she sings. It's not like they turn on the effect and then she sings. They're slowly changing that. So let me know if you can hear this right here. It starts clean and then you can hear it turn dirty. You couldn't save me, but you can't let me go. And then of course they crank up the retune speed of whatever pitch correction she's used to further kind of depart her vocal from what we heard before. From what I can tell, it doesn't sound like anything's tuned on this. Well, besides that part. Everything before it was super raw and human. I don't even think it's time-aligned, to be honest, which is very open-ended. So the fact then, you know, they're just trying to further depart the story now from where she was or what she's thinking, her train of thought, and from the verse. And of course, does a great job at that. Okay, let's unpack this. So let's start with the drums. Really interesting to not present a backbeat on the first four bars here. It's just the stomp. We're just being introduced to the concept. I think this shows great production restraint to not kind of give us everything that we may want in that moment, even though we do want it. Trust me, we do want it and we get it. So I love that. Very simple. It's just, you just can't help but feel it. It's the evolved version of the verse, but still feels very new because if I'm not mistaken, there's a good amount of new samples and sounds blended in there. A lot more mid-range, a lot looser, a lot dirtier, a lot crunchier, everything that we need it to be. Now, let's talk about the bass. I love that the entire mix feels distorted here from how overdone the bass is. Now with this bass, it's really interesting because that is not the bass I expected based on bass. Okay, the legato bass here, the open. I expected it to be more of a swelling, lush, long bass, but they went with this percussiveness that still sounds really full. So I really love how it caught my eye, caught my ear in that way. And now we have chord movement too. And of course, we don't even get to the point of resolve until the second half of this chorus unleashment of energy. Because this chord is not... If I had to do it by ear, I think that's a flat 6, 4, and then 1 in the minor key. Because that's the home chord, right? And of course, now I want to hit on, before we get to the drum stuff in the back half, I want to talk about the synth stuff going on. So. I'm sure, of course, you can kind of hear the... I can't even quite get up there, but that little bit on top that's holding down... it sounds like it's holding down the tonic or the five. I can't quite tell, to be honest, which I know is not a good thing to admit when your relative pitch may not be as perfect as you people think it is. But that is an interesting, again, tension point against the movement of the bass. We have one thing that's staying stagnant, and then the bass is slowly separating and moving alongside of it. And it just adds this motif of how we've kept this droning going on. It's still very droning, very powerful in its own way. And then interestingly enough, the one thing you expect to be sidechained in this section would be the keys, but they do not sidechain it. You can hear it just living its best life right here. Is that little organ synth pad that they have going on. It's not sidechaining. It's actually really surprising that it's not sidechaining, but I really appreciate that it doesn't, because that's kind of the easier default move to make things feel intense. And I love that they opted for on the edge of too much distortion instead of giving us exactly what we were hoping for. Now, I believe that's everything. Yeah, so those are all the main elements, but I do want to hit on the snare thing really quick. That snare. They have two different snare blends. One, they're both huge. The first one is a little tighter, a little less on the sides. The second one's a little longer and more on the sides. Check it out. And then reverse. And then that little reverse in the back too, just adding some extra flavor and intrigue. Really common thing to reverse a snare into a downbeat or into another snare hit. Now, melodically, this synth is doing something really cool. It's hitting on the flat five, which is something they do in Bad Guy, which just works really well for this style of Billie here. So it sounds really menacing. It sounds really ominous. It sounds out of place. It doesn't sound out of place. It sounds totally in place. But as far as harmonically, what's going on? Yep, that's a flat five. And the synth, again, now we've contrasted it hugely. Unsurprisingly, these are people who love insane dynamic range. Now we've gone from this huge crunch to the cleanest, nice, softest little glider-rooney synth we could find. And then now we're also back on the kick. We have our verse kick sound in that synth, a little ad-lib. 30 on the 30 for another year. And then these two sounds here, they could almost be anything when you cut that little of a piece out. If I had to guess, it sounds like a kick and a snare or percussive element that they took off the front end, and then they're just using the sustain of it so it comes in kind of soft. So check this out. That could be the back half of a kick sample and the back half of a percussive backbeat snare-esque sample there. Easy. But it's hard to tell, and ultimately these are only things that we would know if we could look in the session. That's my best guess. How do we create it though? 30 on the 30 for another year. I can barely go outside. I think I hate it here. Maybe I should think about a new career. Now, let's talk about how they've already evolved this section here. Of course, the vocals. 30 on the 30 for another year. I can barely go. Did you think I'd show up in the machine? We have the same bendy. And yeah, our cat's napping now. He has chilled out. So we have that, but then we have the response here. Another year. Again, a very hip hop rooted move to, you know, be your echo, be do your ad lib, your response back in that way. I think I hate it here. Maybe I should think. And then I like that choice to kind of be looser and expressive with that ad lib. I think I hate it here. Like, oh, I think I hate this. It's a little more in her head than to be, I think I hate it here. I like that this was kind of a more vulnerable, just talking the thought. And then just a, like she's really contemplating it. And then it starts to kind of get even crazier. So before we get into that, we have that synth from the first post chorus from just before. But because it's all works on the same chord, now it's like they introduce the synth concept and now we bring it into the verse. And our verse has evolved having that over because it's a one note bass line. It's really a minor chord to the diminished chord, the root diminished chord. And it works great over that same bass line anyways. So it's like wonderful. And she's only singing the 2-1. Is that an, barely go outside and get it here. She's only ever singing 2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-3-1. So she's never really touching the flat five harmonically anyway. So that's how we're getting away with root minor chord, root diminished chord, over a verse melody, if that makes sense. Because she's never more than a third, never closer than a minor third away from what the synth is doing. I have a feeling if she was too much, it would get kind of gross. So then again, of course, continuing these motifs, continuing forward. Now, there's one little thing in here. I can't tell if that's the exact same sample or not, to be honest, but now, okay, there's something I didn't realize right now. Two things. One, this B verse, whatever you want to call it, kind of follows the first four bars of what you would expect in a blues song if it was in minor. Going from the one chord, 1-1-4-1 is the beginning of a lot of blues music. Go 1-1-4-1-5-4-1-1 or 1-1-4-1-5-4-5-4-1-1. There's a bunch of different ways that we could arrange the blues. But she does that here. It's a minor one. One chord with the ad lib. Minor one again. Minor four. And we're back. So that was a move done in the blues. That was like how most of us have heard 1-1-4-1 chord progressions before was from blues music. So that's just something I smelled. And then check this. You can't keep me up. No. Check this. And then, of course, now this is the only time that synth spent the whole time only going to the flat five. Now it's going to the four because it can't do the flat five on top of this minor four chord. Almost didn't catch that. Almost did not catch that. Now, I don't want to point at the obvious that there's obviously a higher billie happening. But what I want to point out is that now, instead of it being a dropout for the drums, they keep the kick drum. Right? Because you couldn't save me, but you can't let me go. Compared to? You couldn't save me, but you can't let me go. Couldn't And the thing is, when you revisit sections, you don't have to do a ton to make them feel good. Now, let me explain. Because when you add two new elements, you don't need to go and change every aspect of, like, every piece of the pre-chorus to make it unique and totally special. All you have to really do is adding in percussive element from before in the song that wasn't there now, and then, right, we're just throwing a harmony on. It sounds like the swells and the bass is largely the same here, and it feels transformed. I just want to say that because I feel like a lot of people overcomplicate that transition, and it can be a lot simpler than you might think. Now, granted, I think this is the same chorus. It's just the vocal. I think it's simpler than we think. They start with the snare, but besides that, instrumentally, it's the same. Now, another little theory bit for the nerds in the house. If you are a music theory nerd and this stuff is appreciative for you, comment below and let me know. If you don't want to hear about this, also please let me know. I'm only indulging the side because this is how I do interpret things. And I think it's a way for me to communicate some of the stuff that's happening in the song to you effectively. Now, this part here. This is really cool because it's going from a flat 6 to a dominant 5, you know, leading back into the 1. And then on top of that, she is sitting on no, 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 no. Yep. So she's sitting on the harmony that would fit for the 5 chord on the flat 6. So they stay on this harmony, and then the chords just move a half step as they maintain that droning energy, which again has been a motif of this entire video, and it works so, so well. Right, really dramatic. Well, and then we get the band doing that movement, really dramatic. Now there's a couple cool little bits here that I really appreciated. There's one beautiful, bright, unstable, shaky synth that is emerging up as she sings the first line. And that is, again, a really simple but elegant way to elevate a section, especially as we're continuing in a big section, we want to push it up a notch. We have one more synth, you know, that we can fit in there to really just make the energy feel a little more open and bombastic. Now, of course, on the production end, we also have the fact that this is the first time we're really getting a huge delay out of her voice, one that we can actually hear and, like, point at. It's so interesting too. I didn't notice this, and I didn't know, like, until I filmed this right now. I'm sure this is something that most people don't hear either. The delay is not evenly distributed. There's an initial delay on the right when the left happens, or roughly when the left happens as well, but then it's the left that trails on. So check this out. Really interesting. Now, nope. Okay, let's talk about this outro. Because, right, this is where you think of it. What's really cool now is the fact that because this song ends on the tonic, they're really just playing with how they drone it out, how, as they have done the whole song, in a really cool way. So she just repeats that last line. You almost think you're going to get more, and like you want more, but then they don't give it to you. And it's that kind of unsettledness completion that I think makes Billie such a force to be reckoned with in how these arrangements come together. And then, now, do you notice how the bass opened up at the end of NDA like this? Because it's been pretty closed in, but then you can hear a filter opens up and the bass gets a bit more chubby, tubby in the mid-range and bigger sounding instead of tight. It helps it sound more rounded out and finished instead of just like we're looping the bass through. Okay, here's the outro. It's just, oh, it sounds final when the bass kind of takes one more notch up and it goes like, it is the ending. You better hear this. And I really loved that detail too. It's like I could feel this journey was coming to an end just by the way of opening that filter up in the shaping of the bass. Now, if I had to make a guess about that, because, you know, with this duo, it could be anything. If I had to make my guess, I think that vocal effect is Billie singing formant shifted down and formant shifted around. Because formant shifting, I want to show you if you... Never mind, it's not going to work. Except with how I have it routed right now, I can't get the mic in here. It's only going to the place I need it to go right now. So I totally lied. I cannot show you that. But hopefully, you know, it'll just be cut out in the edit. And if not, it'll look really goofy because it's in here and I'm talking about it. And I don't want you to leave me because YouTube relies on watch time. And I want to be blessed by the algorithmic gods for the self-validation I need to continue going on in life. All right, so let's just finish this. So what I think happened is that she's using something like a formant shifter to mangle her voice to sound unreal sounding, but keeps the melody of it. So she may have easily sung this. You know, doing that ad lib, and then they can make it sound more masculine and midzy and mangled, and it still keeps the same pitch. So that's what I feel like is happening here. But I also like that, again, they've returned home to the untunedness of this song, because this ending, you know, gets off pitch like a human does. It's loose and dirty and stanky, and I love that about it. Oh! Duh. Really interesting, too. I totally forgot how they do have some of those reverses after beat four. And then that song brilliantly goes right into the next one on the album. I'm not your friend. And that is everything I have for you today about Billie Eilish's NDA. If you really enjoyed this and want to have more, let me know in the comments. How do you like this new? This is a really quick, easier to execute setup because I'm also revamping how content gets to you because I want to bring you more value, more conversations like this. I had some issues with the camera setup, but I had to get it done because I want to be here with you today. So thank you for your time. I understand what it means to spend it here with me. It is just something that I don't take lightly. So hope it was worthwhile. Would love to know what you thought down below and what other songs you'd like me to dissect the production and the vocals of next. If you want more, you can see down in the description, there's links to reach out to myself and my team to work together in a couple different capacities. If not, it's just great to have you here in general. I hope you have a fantastic rest of your day. Now get out there, work hard, and remember, kindness wins.